Welcome to our talk from Device to Cloud, Prototyping Your IoT Use Case. We are working for Grandcentrics, an IoT service provider and a Vodafone company. My name is Bastian Schlich and with me is Raphael Reuters. I'm heading the Competence Center System and Infrastructure, and we are developing back-end and cloud solutions and operating them, and also we are developing web front-end solutions. Raphael, some words from you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Raphael Reuters, and I'm a team lead for a backend team at Grandcentrics for Bastian's team. And as he already has mentioned, we develop cloud solutions for your business case.
And today we would like to show you how you can use our cellular IoT offering to quickly implement your IoT use case. IoT use cases are like manifold. There's today plentitude of cases where you can use IoT, for example, in a smart building, smart home, in smart city, smart logistics. And probably most of you know the smart home cases. It used to be that if you wanted to have a smart home, you needed to pick one vendor, and then you were stuck with one vendor. Nowadays, you can implement and integrate products of very different vendors into your smart home without the need to being stuck to one vendor. Other use cases in the IoT domain are from smart cities and smart logistics. And if you have a product, it's sometimes difficult to come up with a good use case for an IoT use case. Most probably and best start with thinking about who is the beneficiary of your IoT use case. Is it the vendor of the product, meaning you get more data on your product and you can use this data to actually improve your product? It can also be the installer of the product, for example, for a heating system. It can be made easier for the installer to install the heating system, or there can be additional service offered by the installer. Last but not least, the beneficiary could be actually the customer, enabling the customer to use more features of the product, to use the product more easily, to interact with the product in more ways. Once you have identified your use case, it is good to test the use case. Is that use case really, really working? And therefore, today, we want to show you our solution of how you can quickly implement your IoT use case. I'll start with a description of what we mean with the term cellular IoT. Then I'll present our solution. After that, detail the technical details of the used components. And after that, Raphael will give a live demonstration of our solution. When you start developing your IoT use case, you need to find out how to connect your product. Here we see on the left your product, a hardware product, and you want to connect it to one of your services that we see on the right on the slide. It might be a cloud service, it might be an application, it might be something that you host in your IT infrastructure. And the question now is, how do you want to connect your product to your service? There's plenty of ways to connect your product to your service. The probably best known way is in using Wi-Fi. You would integrate the Wi-Fi capability into your product, and then the customer, when getting the product, would onboard the product to the Wi-Fi, and then you would use the Wi-Fi to connect to your service. Another way that is similar is, for example, ZigBee, where the customer also would need to install an additional gateway, would hook up the product to the ZigBee gateway, and then connect this to via his router to the internet. Another way often used in consumer products is the Bluetooth. So you connect the product to the mobile of the customer, and then you use this Bluetooth link to connect to your service. Of course, with the disadvantage that the mobile needs to be close to your product and you only have a connection once the mobile is in reach. The third way is using wide area networks, and we listed some here. Some of them are using licensed frequencies, others are using open frequencies. LoRaWAN and SIGFOX using a non-licensed one, NB-IoT, LTE-M, and 5G using licensed ones. The advantage of the licensed ones is that we have service guarantees on them. And here in this talk, we will focus on the NB-IoT. So what are the advantages of narrowband IoT? Why do we focus on NB-IoT here in this talk? First of all, you don't need to have any onboarding. And other different to the wireless case, you don't need to hook it up to a wireless network, need to use the wireless LAN password and deal with all the things of the firewalls that are probably installed. No activation is needed. Customer just needs to plug in the device and just power it on, and ability to communicate is guaranteed. Another advantage of the NB-IoT is that you have a good coverage even inside buildings or even below buildings, which is different to other technologies listed there. Because coming back, if you have a heating in your cellar, most of the time you will not have wireless LAN access down there. Another advantage is the low power consumption, which enables battery use cases. So you don't even need a power plug for your device. That might be a soap dispenser in the bathroom where you don't have a power supply near, where you could just plug, put the hardware and use the battery. And last but not least, we have security by design in narrowband IoT, and I will come back to that later. So now we have the product. We choose narrowband IoT as a cellular technology, and we have your service. Question is, what is now needed to actually make that happen? And what is needed is two additional parts, two additional components. That is the connectivity board on the one side. Connectivity board is a product from us that we build into your product that enables your product to communicate via NB-IoT with your service. On the other side, you need the cellular hub, which is a service that takes the messages from the cellular network and routes it towards your service and translates data towards a format that is understood by your service. In this talk today, we will focus on the data device. So as a product, together with the connectivity board, we use the data device connected to NB-IoT, and we are a cellular hub connected to the Demo IoT cloud. The Demo IoT cloud is here the service that we use for demo purposes. The data device is a mock device. It sends data, it measures the temperature, humidity, air pressure. It also has the possibility via the dial to enter a number there. And then this number can either be used as the limit for the temperature and the other values, or in one of the modes can also be used as an input for a counter that you can decrease with a button. And Raphael will show some of the details later. The connectivity board is a product from us that connects your product securely with your service. It enables cellular connectivity using open IoT standards, NB-IoT I already mentioned before, and we are also using lightweight M2M. Lightweight M2M is a protocol, open IoT standard protocol, and it's spoken between the connectivity board and the cellular hub. The connectivity board enables your product to send information and also to receive command and information from your service. Additionally, it allows for over-the-air updates. It is a hardware extension module for your product, and you can connect it via a CLIO, that means RS-232. It consists of the hardware plus a software SDK that you can integrate in your software. It's a blueprint, that means it can be extended to your needs if needed. It's based on the Nordic chip for digital inputs, for analog inputs, and two digital outputs. And together with the daughter boards, it has a CE certification. Some examples for daughter boards, we have an RS-485 so that you can connect to a mod-up Modbus installation if you're using that in your product. We have a connectivity to programmable logic controllers, and we also have a daughter board for low voltage power supplies for the battery cases, for example, for the soap dispenser, if you are not going with a power plug there. The application area of the connectivity board is a proof of concept, MVPs, and smaller lot sizes. If you are reaching for bigger lot sizes, we would recommend going for customer-specific hardware, and we, of course, can develop that for you. There's two ways to integrate it. First of all, we could integrate it into your product, but you could also integrate it into your product, and then you would just need to implement against our API and integrate our framework in your software. And the steps that you would need to be doing is, first of all, you would need to define the protocol between your product and the connectivity board, because the protocol between the connectivity board and the cellular hub is already defined by us. Then you would need to integrate our software in your our framework in your software, and you would need to map your data into the lightweight M2M data model. The next component that we are using here is the cellular hub, and it is responsible to route the messages from the Vodafone network towards your network, your solution, the internet. And in the same process, we also map the messages from the message format lightweight M2M that we are using towards message format that is understood by your service. Additional services that we offer are billing services, device provisioning services, the factory integration, and also firmware updates, so over-the-air updates. As mentioned before, we have security by design here. We have security on three layers. We have the LTE encryption for the network. Between the Vodafone network and the cellular hub, we have the IPsec tunneling, and between the device all the way towards the cellular hub, we have the DTLS authentication, so we can make sure that actually the right devices are talking to us. The cellular hub is highly scalable. It's a multi-tenant solution. It's deployed in a managed Kubernetes cluster in Microsoft Azure, and we can scale it horizontally and also geographically if needed. It receives the messages, lightweight M2M messages from the cellular network via UDP, and we translate it then to TCP/IP traffic, and we also do a data mapping towards the services listed here. So we translate towards Azure IoT Hub, towards SAP Cloud, towards an MQTT broker, then we would use JSON there, or we also support in custom REST with JSON. Now we have a look at the architecture of the cellular hub. On the left, you see the device, and the device here talks via lightweight M2M with the cellular hub and sends telemetry information, status update, and on the same way is able to receive commands and cloud device messages from the IoT framework, and also to receive firmware over the air. On the right side, you see your IoT platform. And again, the telemetry data and the status update are sent to your IoT platform, and you can send back commands and cloud to device messages that are then sent off towards your device. On the south, you see the different services, additional services that we offer. We have a SIM management towards Vodafone GDSP. We connect different authentication providers to manage users that have access to the cellular hub. And we also are sending billing events to a billing system of your choice. You also see there that we have a command line interface for administration and integration purposes. The last component that I would like to introduce today is Demo IoT Cloud. The purpose is a generic web front end with back end to collect and present data. And we came up with this because we saw in many projects that customers didn't have services ready, or Sometimes it was a big organizational effort to integrate us into their service, not on the technical side, but on the organizational side. So who is responsible for what? Who is allowed to do what? And into which stage would we integrate? Sometimes we are doing proof of concepts, and customer might not want to integrate that into his production systems, or different departments were involved. For example, we were mostly talking to the engineering departments, but the cloud service was operated by the IT departments, and we didn't want to look into that in the start of the project. So the demo IT cloud gives the customer the ability to have a feasibility check for the IoT use cases. You see some screens on the right side, but Raphael will go into details in a minute here in the demo. You can gather some initial data, you can work with the collected data, and you can interact with devices. The features is you have a device listing where you can see all the devices that belong to you together with the geolocations. You can see the details of a device. If you click on a device, you see the real-time messages coming in. You can query the device messages, for example, temperature thresholds or whatever values you are sending. And you can have a structured message export to Excel, because many companies still doing their data analytics on Excel, and you can get a first grip on your data using Excel there. And then we also support a remote device configuration in case your device is capable of doing so. As for the cellular hub, the Demo IoT Cloud is a multi-tenant cloud solution. It's highly scalable, also runs on Microsoft Azure in a managed Kubernetes cluster. We are also using as a data store a PostgreSQL there managed on Azure. And for the handling of the messages, we are operating a clustered BurnMQ message broker there. The web front end is an extendable JavaScript Vue.js web front end. And to make customization easy, we have a way to do that easily. And you can customize colors, icons, and data representation. So to give a little bit home to the colors of the company that we are implementing this for. This shows the architecture of the Demo IoT Cloud. Also on the left, again, the cellular hub sending the data via MQTT to the VernMQ cluster. The VernMQ cluster, then we get the data from the VernMQ cluster with the Demo IoT Cloud backend. We store the data in a PostgreSQL database. We connected Auth0 as the identity provider for managing the users and the rights of the users to the Demo IoT Cloud. So we define who can see what and who can execute what on the devices. And then we have a WebSocket connection to the IoT Cloud front end, which enables the actualization of the data without a page reload. And this brings us to the live demo. I will hand over to Raphael.
Thank you very much, Bastian, for this nice introduction and the nice overview about NB-IoT and LWM2M. And as Bastian already mentioned, I will show you now the demo cloud. This is what you see, what we have here. We are logged in as a user, as user with one device, as you can guess here in the down. And I use this data device I've brought here with me to showcase that, to show some features we want to present here. So first of all, I want to explain why we did that. Bastian already mentioned our motivation, and then from this motivation, we went a little bit on. And so first of all, we wanted to give customers, possible customers, to check if NB-IoT, if that works, right? So usual cellular connectivity doesn't work, for example, in the cellular, and NB-IoT does because of physical effects. So we want to check quickly, is it possible, is it feasible to introduce that into your product landscape? The next thing we want to see probably very quickly is what data can we gather? And then the next step is, okay, what can we do with this data? So usually what you do is you analyze that somehow, And we also wanted to give the possibility here to do that actually quite quickly and quite easily. So when you have your use case and you're not sure if you want to introduce NB IoT into your products, this is a very simple, very quick solution to check, okay, is it working? What do we get? How can we work on this? So from this motivation on, we started to create this nice little application. And as you see here, some things are changing, but let's go from top to bottom. So here in the top, we see two charts. On the left-hand side, we see a bar chart. And on the right-hand side, we have a radar chart. The bar chart is actually quite simple. You see the total amount of messages. So currently, we have sent 7,924 messages. And those messages are derived or grouped by a day, so on a daily basis. So February 11th and, for example, February 16th have been sent very many messages, for example. And already from this simple thing, so it's not a big deal, just the amount of data, amount of messages, you can say, okay, on those days something is happening and you can investigate if there's like an anomaly, if something shouldn't behave like this, right? So quite easy, quite simple, but still the first gain of knowledge here. On the right-hand side, you see the radar chart, and as the name suggests, the period of use, you see when were the messages sent. So this is not a grouping by day, but on a time basis, on an hour basis, and you see here, for example, between 2 and 3 p.m. and also between 6 and 8 p.m., stuff has happened. So probably in this time, I have tested the device and the connection and stuff. So that's why we see there the graph. Again, here could be already something cool for use cases for you. For example, when you see that messages are sent in the nighttime, so between let's say 10 p.m. and 2 a.m., and the nature of NB IoT and LWM to M is somewhat event based. So when an event happens, you want to transmit and that it happened. And then you would already see, okay, you see many messages, okay, something is wrong probably, or could be that there's something wrong in the nighttime. Cool. So coming back from the top, so we go from the bar charts south, you see a list of your devices. Currently, I only have this one device I've just shown you. We see here just random information like your ID for your device. You can give the device some meta information like a name or a location. And what you also see is the last message and when it was received. So the idea behind this is, okay, you see that there is connection, right? So you see times changing here. So you see, okay, messages are transmitted periodically. So, okay, all our devices are fine. When you would have multiple ones, you would have multiple rows or multiple pages. For simplicity's sake, we only have one device, so that's for this part. I will come to this later on, but let's first of all go more south here, and you see your filters. Your filters, as the name already suggests, you can filter your messages. So let's say this device sending temperature sensor values, and you have a business case of you're providing a swimming pool and you don't want to, or you want to assure that there is never a time that there is the water temperature above 60 degrees Celsius, for example. So you can create filters, and on your events which are happening, you can filter and see, okay, there is something happened, and you got real new information for your business case for this part. So that's actually very, very nice because, again, of the nature of LWM2M, the properties you can search for, they are dynamically adjusted to the messages the device sends. So it's actually quite easy. I have just one random one here, a temperature above 22 degrees for a given time span. And you see some messages that happened in a time. And when you see some and you wouldn't expect, for example, some, then you would say, okay, something's odd here. We have to adjust again our environment, that part. So that's very easy. You can create multiple ones, you can delete some, that's up to you, that's out of the box there, and you get some real nice information about your environment. In the bottom of the page, you see the location. You see, okay, we are here in Düsseldorf. It's not that fancy. When you would have multiple ones, you have a zoomed out map, and you would see, for example, all your devices in Germany. Now we go back to Düsseldorf because we only have one device here. Coming back to the top and clicking on this one single device, you see a device details website with the metadata on top. You see a remote configuration button here. I will come to this later. Again, the bar chart that's specific for this one device. In this case, the numbers are the same because for this user, there's only one customer, one device per provision. On the right, you have this small mini map, and here you have your device messages. And here, for demonstration purposes, we have a lot of messages with the device time, so it's nothing that special, but we wanted to showcase that something is happening. So you see, okay, device time is changing. But for example, you see a humidity and temperature values for this room here or for this environment where this data device lies. And yeah, so that's nice because you see different values when things happen. So when an event happened, you get the information. And again here, because of the nature of LWM2M, we have those dynamic rows like barometer, counter, the device time, the humidity or the temperature. So when you would have your use case, so when you would gather different information than those displayed here, it would dynamically adjust to it because LWM2M, so this lightweight machine-to-machine protocol, is basically a data format. It's much more, but for this, it's just a data format. And it's very nicely designed that it's extendable, and there's a lot of specified values like barometer or temperature and humidity. And so the page adjusts very naturally to your needs because that's the information your device sends. So that's actually a very nice, cool thing. You see the temperature, humidity, as I mentioned. And so that's it. You see the time here changing for the device. So coming back to the top, I already mentioned the remote configuration button. And usually you don't only want to receive data from your device, but it's very natural that you want also to send data downwards, for example, for configuration purposes. So when you have some kind of events and you want to change the threshold for something, then when time flies by, you usually need to adjust the threshold because of, for example, governmental issues or reasoning on other ways. Then you can do this quite easily via this remote configuration. You need to put the correct value here for the object you want to change. And I want to change the LCD display you have just seen. And we want to change the value to 20. So currently the value is on 7. I hope you can read that through my camera here. And when we set it to 20, it automatically changes back to 20. So that's nice, quite easy proof that there is connection downwards also, so that the whole pipeline, so the messages go through from my laptop via the internet to the cellular hub, downwards over the mobile network, over the NB-IoT network from Vodafone, down to this single device. So adjusting values on your device is also very, very easy for threshold reasoning. I mentioned in the beginning that we have a lot of messages and we want to analyze these messages. And as you have seen here and also on the device details, it's not that super cool to analyze. You see your messages and you see something's happening and you see the current state of your environment, but what you can't do is to do real analysis. And also when you want to do, for example, AI, artificial intelligence on this, that's not a data set you would usually work on. So what we implemented is a download or an export for your messages in an Excel format. And I've just switched to an example here. And what you can see here are those different values the device sends. So for example, we see here humidity min measured value and max measured value, and also the sensor value. And what that is, Maybe you are wondering why we haven't seen those on the device details page. That's again because you see this this X list is quite bright. So we said, okay, let's group them there. So all humidity values are in one column. And for your real analysis, you would have those messages split here. And you can do all your logic you would usually do in later processing. You can do it on basis of those information here. So very nice export of all your data and easily split into the real values your device senses. And with this, I would like to summarize once again the Demo IoT Cloud. It's very nice and easy to check your use case. If it works, it's very quickly set up. And with a data device, we have a very nice showcase and use case. You can already gain the first information here. And now I would like to thank you for your attention and hand over back to Bastian.
Thanks, Raphael. Yeah, to summarize, cellular IoT beyond narrowband IoT enables many use cases. The main advantages I would like to emphasize here is no onboarding is needed, no searching for the wireless LAN password, no setting up of additional gateways, and you have a good coverage even inside buildings and below buildings. We are enabling many business cases here, remote monitoring case, remote configuration case, remote update case, and a remote control case. Some of them Raphael mentioned in the live demo. We have a ready hardware, software, and service for cellular IoT. We have the connectivity board and the cellular hub already being used in the real product. Additionally, we have the Demo IoT Cloud, which offers a configurable web front and a back end, and which has a basic device listing, viewing device details, working with collected data, and exporting data to Excel to get your business case started. In case you want something specific, we of course also are happy to integrate your service that you already have or are also capable of building a service for you. As an outlook, we are adding support for LTE-M. For other use cases, we are adding more cloud service providers. We are adding Amazon here, AWS. We are also looking into other third-party clouds and services because integration into as many services as possible is key to this idea here. We're adding support for AMQP message brokers to also be more flexible on this side. And as an additional service for the Demo IoT Cloud, we are adding the Microsoft Data Link here. So thanks for your attention. We hope you enjoyed the talk and the live demonstration. If you got your interest or if you have any open questions, please just contact us. And thanks a lot from us.